Good morning. Welcome to the First Christian Church on this nice, rainy, cool day on this beautiful Palm Sunday morning. I'm going to go over a few of the announcements. Our Sunday school is at 9:30 a.m. and it follows the school calendar, so if there's no school, there's no Sunday school. And there's also adult Sunday school at 9:30 a.m. and fellowship is at 9:30 a.m. as well, if you'd like to have coffee with everybody. And our worship service is at 10:30. March 24th today, we are celebrating Palm Sunday, and the kids will be bringing down some palm branches, and we'll be having entertainment by the Saw Band performing this morning. Wednesday, March 27th, at 6:30 is choir practice. Please be there. Thursday, March 28th at 6:30 is Monday Thursday service, so there'll be no Bible study that day. March 29th at 10 a.m., Nisha Productions for a monthly birthday party. Sunday, March 31st is the Easter Sunday. Sunrise service is at 7 a.m., followed by the Easter brunch. There is a sign-up sheet for anyone wishing to help with the brunch and make something for it. There will be an Easter egg hunt at 9:30 during Sunday school time, so there'll be no official Sunday school class. And there will be an Easter egg hunt as well during the Sunday school class. So instead of Sunday school, they'll have an Easter egg hunt. They'll be doing a little lesson afterwards when they get done with the egg hunt, and they'll be singing some songs. So, and then Thursday, April 4th, the Boy Scout leaders will meet here at 6:15. And we will also have our last Bible study session that day at 6:30. Wednesday, April 10th at 10 a.m., the CWF meets at church in the Fellowship Hall. Saturday, April 13th from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m., Nurture Her Soul by Mandy McCleary Ministry at United Methodist Church in Villisca. The $30 includes a light breakfast and worship and fellowship. There's a couple of phone numbers on there if you'd like to join that. Thursday, April 18th from 4:30 to 6:30 p.m. is the Pork Chop Supper. It's $12 per meal. It will be a drive-through again. You can purchase your tickets at the CMF from any of the church members, or there is, I believe you can get them in the church office. Yes. Please let AJ or one of the elders know if someone is in the hospital or in need of a visit. If you have a prayer concern, there's cards in the pews for you to share your concern. There's offering envelopes in the pews and in the basket on the back table for offering. I wanted to let you know that the beautiful flowers in the front here are in memory of Joanne Harris. So they are very beautiful. Harms. Sorry, I can't read. Harms. Any other announcements? Yes. Okay. All right. May the peace of Christ be with you. Let us greet one another in Christ. Thank you.
Two verses, Steve, two verses. Okay.
At this time, I welcome you to First Christian Church. Whether you're worshiping with us online or in person, we're very glad you decided to join us this morning. At this time, please sit back and enjoy our opening prelude, Help is on the Way by Toby Mack.
Life to say, help is on. Sometimes it's days, sometimes it's years. Some face a lifetime of falling tears. But he's in the darkness, he's in the cold. Just like the morning, he always shows.
Will you please pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, as we enter Holy Week, turn our hearts to you and the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Stir up within us the gift of faith that we may not only praise him with our words, but with our hearts and minds. In your Son's holy name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. Once again, friends, it is great to have you here in worship this morning as we gather this Palm Sunday. We gather with a joy of celebration and excitement. And in that spirit, we are blessed this morning to have the Sundogs Saw Band helping out with our worship music this morning. I must confess, this is the first time I've heard a musical saw, and I'm very impressed. It is very cool. I'm very excited to see what other surprises you have in store for us this morning. But if anyone else has any good news, any joys to share with the body of Christ, please share them at this time. Yes, Diane. Yes. We have, if you can't smell it, if you're at home, sorry, we haven't figured out how to get the good smells to you yet, but yes, absolutely. We have a delicious soup luncheon happening after this that'll have a free will donation, and all donations will go to the Church General Fund to help offset our rising insurance costs, as you undoubtedly know, but please stay behind and enjoy some fellowship and some yummy soup. My house has been smelling amazing for the past like 18 hours, so I hope you guys enjoy as well. Any other good news to share this morning? Not seeing any. This is also a time where we can come to unload our burdens, to share our... Yes. Cleet's birthday is coming up. Thought we were going to get away with it. Yes. Oh, yeah. Your mom's birthday is on Monday. All sorts of birthdays coming up. Happiest of birthday to both of you. Thank you for spending your Sunday with us today, and I hope you're hungry. At this time, if anyone also has any prayer requests or concerns, we can share those with the body of Christ at this time. Yes. Absolutely. Prayers go out to Marlon and his family for his untimely loss. Prayers for comfort, for guidance during this time of transition as they learn to kind of cope and continue to go on living. Any other prayer requests this morning? Yes. What was the last name? Freeze. Marlon Freeze. From Colorado. Gotcha. Thank you. Any other prayer requests this morning? Not seeing any, will you join me in a time of prayer? Lord God, thank you for the spirit of celebration. God, it may be wet and rainy and windy outside, but it is warm and comfortable and joyous in here. God, help us to find reasons to celebrate you, no matter what storms may be going on outside our doors or inside our hearts and lives. God, there's always a good time to celebrate and thank you. And we continue in prayer this morning with the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The scripture reading today is from Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11. You can follow along in the Pew Bibles on page 21 and 22 if you'd like. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. And a very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that have followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." Bless the reading of his word.
Try this again. There we go. Now it's on my ear. Good morning. Today, as I was listening to Shelley read the Bible, I was thinking about something that is really exciting to go to. Even when you're a kid, it's even more exciting, I think. Okay? How many of you have been to a parade? Ooh. What kinds of things do you see? You've been in a parade too. You see candy, yes.
And you throw out candy from a truck.
Yes, sometimes people in parades throw the candy out so you can get some candy. What else, Bryn? Toys. Yeah, you might see toys. They might have little trinket toys to throw out. Water bottles, because sometimes during parades it's hot in the summertime. We even pass out water bottles for Vacation Bible School, don't we? What else?
Friends,
you see your friends. If you're in the parade, you're like, "Yeah, there they are. Look at me. I'm so cool." And if you're watching the parade, you'd be like, oh, that's my best friend. There she goes. Right? Yeah. What else, Clara? Say it one more, la louder. Frisbees. They might be throwing frisbees out. Bouncy balls. What else, Andy? Yeah, making sure they throw out candy. Cooper. Four-wheelers. Racers, definitely. Bryn. Oh, racers. What? Water bottles. Greg, can you change the slide real quick? Sometimes there's even big things like balloons, right? Yeah, this was a big parade. Do you see, where are the people that are watching?
On the side.
And the parade goes right down the middle, right? Well, would you believe it if I said Jesus had a parade?
Yeah,
he did have a parade. Now, he didn't pass out candy. He didn't have balloons. Yeah, you might see fire trucks in our parades. Do you think Jesus had firefighters in his parade? No, but he still had a parade. There were people waving palm branches, and they were doing something else with their leaves. They were laying them on the ground so that the donkey that he was riding on was walking on the leaves instead of just on the ground. They even took their coats off and laid them on the ground for him to go over, kind of like a carpet, right? Would you take your coat off for these people in a parade? No, that would be really silly. But they loved Jesus so much, they celebrated him and had a parade for him. Greg, sorry, I know you're busy. Can we see one more picture? Here is a picture of someone that drew it for Jesus. Do you see him riding on that donkey? He's going right down the middle of the people. They have the palm branches down, and they were celebrating Jesus because they knew Jesus was special. He was coming to save them and forgive their sins. Let's pray to God and say thank you. Mm-hmm. Dear God, thank you for bringing Jesus. He had his very own special parade, and we can remember how special he is. Help us always remember he came to help forgive our sins and save us. Thank you, God. Amen.
Thank you.
What a truly incredible offering. I hope I speak for everyone saying you guys are welcome back anytime you have the availability. And it's such a bummer that a steal like that was only workable in the past 100 years, because based on our palm processional, I think Jesus would have loved a saw or two on his way into Jerusalem. Fair enough. And as we gather this morning together in the presence of our Lord, on this special day, we commemorate Palm Sunday, a significant event not only in the Christian calendar, but one that also begins our Holy Week. Palm Sunday being a day both of celebration, but also introspection for Christians around the world. It commemorates the day that Jesus came into Jerusalem riding a donkey while crowds waved palm branches, shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." This event holds a profound symbolism for Christians and also sets the stage for the culmination of Jesus' earthly ministry, his crucifixion, and ultimately his resurrection. As the beginning of our Holy Week, it marks a time of reflection on the sacrifice that Jesus made for humanity, but also the hope that his resurrection brings. Understanding his entry into Jerusalem is crucial for every believer, I think. It reveals his divine purpose, his unwavering commitment to fulfill God's redemptive plan, but also his role as the promised Messiah. And this morning, as we delve into Matthew chapter 2, we explore the significance of this moment in Jesus' life, what it meant for his ministry, and discover what we can still take from it today as his followers. The triumphal entry of Jesus occurred during the Jewish Passover feast, and Jesus deliberately chose to enter Jerusalem in this manner, in a manner that fulfills a prophecy from the Old Testament, from Zechariah, which states, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victoriously, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The act of Jesus riding on a donkey symbolizes his humility, but also his intentions of peace as the promised Messiah. In the contrast, what many people believed, most people thought he would be a conquering military leader. But Jesus presents himself as a humble and compassionate king, coming not to wage war, but offer salvation and establish God's kingdom here on earth. In response, the crowds did the only thing they could. They spread their cloaks off their back on the road and waved palm branches from nearby trees, snapping them off. And this reflects their recognition of Jesus as the long-awaited Messiah and King. But their understanding of Jesus' kinship was likely influenced by their own hopes, expectations of a political deliverer who would save them from Roman oppression, rather than a spiritual savior who would come and alleviate their sin. As we delve deeper into the account of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, we can't overlook the connection that it has to these Old Testament prophecies. The prophet Zechariah, hundreds of years before Jesus' birth, spoke of a king who would come to Zion, not with the pomp and grandeur of a conquering hero on a war horse, but humility riding on a donkey. The prophecy paints a picture of a king who is gentle, humble, and approachable, all attributes that perfectly describe Jesus. The act of Jesus riding on a donkey holds profound symbolic and cultural significance, because in ancient times, a king riding on a donkey meant that peace was coming, that war was no longer happening. It was a gesture of humility, a sign that the king came to humble before his people. And Jesus' choice was deliberate in this manner. Furthermore, Jesus' humble entry stands in stark contrast to people's own expectations and challenges our preconceived notions of power and authority. It reminds us that God's ways and not our ways are the way to true greatness in the kingdom of God. As we continue his entry, we hear, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." The term Hosanna, something we're building our whole message around this morning, is an exclamation of adoration and praise. It translates to "save us now" or "save us, we pray." And the people recognized in that moment Jesus as who he was, a promised Messiah, a son of David, and they welcomed him with such great joy and expectation. The enthusiastic reception of Jesus by the crowds reveals the diverse expectations people had of him. Many hoped that he would become a military or political leader, overthrow oppression, establish a new earthly kingdom. They saw him as a powerful miracle worker, teacher, and believed he was the only one who could restore Israel's glory. However, others had a different understanding of Jesus' mission. The religious leaders, for instance, viewed Jesus as a threat to their authority, and they were skeptical of his claims, his actions, and they didn't share in the crowd's exuberance. Instead, they sought to discredit him and oppose him. This variety of expectations highlights the complex, multifaceted nature of Jesus' identity and his mission. While many chose to recognize him as the Messiah, their understanding of what that meant was shaped by their own beliefs, cultural, political, and religious. The response of the crowds on Palm Sunday serves as a poignant reminder of the fickleness of human allegiance. Just a few days after welcoming Jesus with shouts of Hosanna, one of the most breathtaking and humble things you could cry, many of these same individuals be the ones turning against him, demanding his crucifixion. Their enthusiasm would wane when they realized that Jesus' kingdom was not of this world and that his mission was not aligned with what they had thought. This shift in allegiance underscores a transience in the nature of human emotions, the danger of placing our trust in earthly leaders, in temporal circumstances, and it challenges us to reflect on our own commitment to Jesus. As we've done this whole Lenten season, we are to consider whether our allegiance is based on faith and understanding or merely on our own desires, our own expectations. The events of Palm Sunday serve as a powerful reminder of the authority and kingship of Christ. As Jesus rode into Jerusalem, fulfilling his prophecy and receiving the enthusiastic praise of crowds, he demonstrated his authority divinely as the promised Messiah, the King of Kings. Today we are called to do the same as those worshipers thousands of years ago, to recognize and acknowledge Jesus' authority in our own lives, not merely as a great teacher, a moral example, but as the Lord of all creation, who has the power to forgive sins, transforms lives, reigns sovereignly over every situation that we face. Recognizing Jesus' authority means submitting to his will and allowing him to rule and reign in every area of our lives. It requires us to trust in his wisdom and his guidance, even when his ways may not align with our own. The varied expectations of people on Palm Sunday highlight these dangers once again. And similarly, we often come to God with our own expectations, our own plans, hoping that he will act according to our wishes. I think March is a beautiful reminder of that. How many people have taken the time to fill out a bracket, maybe just for bragging rights or for maybe a little bit of money in a family wager like Michaela and I have? But realizing that these things are so imperfect. They don't last forever. God's ways are higher than ours. His thoughts higher than ours. Surrendering our expectation to God's will requires humility, trust, but most importantly, it requires a willingness to let go of control. It means acknowledging that God's plans are perfect. He knows what is best for us, even when we can't or choose not to understand his purposes. And Jesus' humble entry into Jerusalem stands as a powerful reminder of humility and servanthood. Despite being the King of Kings, Jesus chose to identify with the lowly and to serve rather than be served. As followers of Christ, we are called to do the same. His example of humility and service is something we need to include in our lives as well. This means putting the needs of others before our own, serving with a willing heart, embracing opportunities to be humble as we follow Jesus' command to love one another. Embracing humility and service is not only a reflection of the character of Christ, but opens the door for God to work through us, to bring us hope, healing, and transformation to those around us. As we've journeyed through the events of Palm Sunday and consider the significant entrance of Jesus, he is faced with a crowd with one question. What does it mean to crown Jesus a king in our lives? To crown Jesus means to acknowledge his lordship over every aspect of our lives. It involves submitting our will, desires, ambition to his authority, and trusting him to guide and direct our paths. It means prioritizing his kingdom and righteousness above all else, and seeking to live in a manner that honors and glorifying him. But most of all, as we've talked about and continue to remember, that crowning Jesus requires daily commitment to seek his face, to find ways to align ourselves with his word. It involves cultivating a personal relationship with him through prayer, worship, the study of scripture, allowing his love and his truth to transform us from the inside out. The example set by Jesus on Palm Sunday as he rode humbly into Jerusalem serves as a reminder of humility, life of service, the life of a true believer. Jesus, the King of Kings, choosing to do what he did best. And as followers of Christ, we are called to do that as well, to lead by his example and put service daily in our lives to others. Whether it's through acts of kindness, volunteering in our community, or simply taking the time to listen and care for those around us, we can all play a part in extending the love and compassion of Jesus to a world more in need of him now than ever. And as we recognize our need for God's wisdom, strength, let us continue to make our way towards the cross next Sunday. Amen. At this time, I invite you to stand and join with me and invite the Saw Band up once again for How Great Thou Art. You may follow along with the words on the screen, or you may follow along in your hymnals on page 33. And if it's your desire to become part of this church, please come forward and make a profession of faith during the final verse of this hymn. If by public confession arrange to be baptized, or if by transfer come, make your intention known and be welcomed into this body of Christ. But for now, let us stand and sing.
Consider
please be seated. And friends, while we may not have cloaks to lay down or palm leaves to spread, we now get an opportunity to reflect on how we can give back to our Heavenly Father, be that through gifts of monetary donation, time, service, and talents. At this time, I invite you to search yourself and see what God is calling you to give at this time. Please come forward and collect the offering.
Will you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, we have seen the blessings that you have put in front of us today with the saw band, the people in the kitchen making the soups for us, the talents that have been shared here at the church. Lord, as we bring our monetary gifts to you, we place them under the cross, and we ask that you bless them and help us to use them in a proper way. Lord, we thank you for all the gifts that you have given us. We ask that you encourage us to take them out into the world and share with all those who do not know you, so that your love and your teachings can be shared with all. In your loving Son's name we pray. Amen.
Will you please continue with me in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, help us to love you as you have first loved us. Help us to realize that if we are to love you, we are to love one another as well. Give us the spirit of sharing so that we may offer you what we have. Challenge us so that we may respond with caring generosity in these gifts we bring to you today. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Friends, while it may be a little dreary out today, I think this honestly makes a perfect backdrop for Palm Sunday, because it's a great reminder that we can find joy not in our circumstances, not in the temporal things happening around us, but we can find joy and contentment in our relationship with Jesus Christ, the only thing in this world that is unchanging, eternal, and forever. So with that in mind, let us gather at his table this morning. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he gathered his followers together. Jesus took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you." He said, "Each time you eat of this bread, do so in remembrance of me." And later in that same meal, Jesus took the cup, the third cup, the cup of redemption, explain to them that this cup represents a new covenant that he is making through his shed blood and the forgiveness of sins to open a gateway to heaven for all who believe. He said, each time you drink of this cup, do so in remembrance of me until I come again. So friends, today let us celebrate and welcome Jesus into Jerusalem in our lives. So let us eat and drink together. At this time, I invite you to stand and join us once again in song for hymn number 477, Pass It On, with help leading worship again, the Sundogs Saw Band. Please be seated. Friends, and as you make your way out of this space this morning, and hopefully into our fellowship hall very hungry, I encourage you to remember the celebration that Jesus entered Jerusalem with, and I invite you to find a way to welcome him just as joyously into your heart and into your everyday. Amen.
He became sin, who knew no sin.
Friends, receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And while I'm here, let us all pray for our meal together, those of you who will be joining in it. Lord God, thank you for this time of fellowship and togetherness and all the food that was so lovingly prepared today. God, let this food fuel our body and let our bodies fuel your mission. And let this time of fellowship and food be a time to bring us closer and closer to you. We say all this in Jesus' name.